Romans chapter 2. I get very, very excited about the opportunity to preach in Romans. This passage, this portion of Scripture is absolutely enlightening. It just explains so much. You know, we Gentile believers are born again with a little bit of a deficit in understanding in many ways because we're not Jewish. Much of Bible doctrine is based around God's supernatural working with His people, the children of Israel. But we have an advantage in a sense in not being Jewish because we're not confused about covenants. Or we oughtn't to be confused about covenants. We haven't grown up having promises from God. By the way, no Jew today has either. But we haven't grown up having promises from God or things that we're looking at from a perspective of being national Israelites. And so when we were born into God's family, we're born into great privilege, being heirs of things that we didn't even know about, had no idea of. And there is a statement or a phrase that is in Romans, and it's in Romans rather frequently, and that is the statement to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And one of the things that is enlightening as the discourse of the dialogue begins in Romans is to help us to understand that there is first, physically, a difference between the Jew and the Greek. And it has to do with the covenant promises God has made to Israel. It helps us as well to understand that for this church at Rome, that the makeup there is Jew and Gentile. When we read Acts, we know that God saved the Greeks. And that the same Holy Spirit that came down in power in the life of the believing Jews filled the believing Gentiles. But one of the confusing things for a lot of the believers at Rome was, what is for us and how are we supposed to live because of being Jewish or being Gentile? In many cases and many times, as you read the Scripture, you understand the Jewish believers were pretty hard on the Gentile believers for not being Jewish. And oftentimes they'd say, you're supposed to do this, or you're supposed to keep this law, or these are things you're supposed to be. You're supposed to be circumcised. You're supposed to, and all of these, you know, you're supposed to practice the law when it comes to cleanliness and a lot of things that were just foreign to the Gentiles. And so Romans helps believers to understand and answer some questions. First of all, what happened to all the promises God made to Israel that are yet unfulfilled? That's a good question, isn't it? I mean, for the Jews, being Jewish and being a believer, they said, well, God still promised us things. And so the question is, what happened to those promises? And it's answered in Romans. For the Gentiles, the question is, why do they have things that aren't for us? And Romans answers those questions. But the doctrine that has been established and is being established is the accountability, first of all, of the Jews and the Gentiles to God. And so before we say, God, you should do this or you should be accountable for this to us, God begins by saying, this is what you're accountable for to me. And there's never a concern when it comes to God's faithfulness, actually, for someone who knows Him, is there? There's never a question of whether or not when God makes a promise, whether or not He'll deliver on it. The question is whether or not we'll be faithful to receive the promise that God has made. So has God ever broken His word? Has He ever lied? Has He ever failed to keep a promise? No. Okay, so the problem isn't with God, and God wants to make that very clear. So I want to read chapter 2 and verse 1. But then after we read chapter 2 and verse 1, I want to go down to verse 11, and then we'll pray. Verse 11 will bring us into our text. Chapter 2, verse 1 was our text for last week. Therefore, thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. For thou that judgest doest the same things. Verse 11. For there is no respect of persons with God. For as many as have sinned without law shall also perish without law, and as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. And now we'll pray, and then we'll look at the content of our message this morning. Father, we have so much to be grateful for. Primarily, first and foremost, is your love for us demonstrated in Jesus Christ. And God, this morning it's important that the gospel is preached, even to the believers, so that we would not only remember your love, but we'll remember your purpose in Christ's coming, and your purpose in all of these things that have to do with laws and ordinances and commands, that the purpose ultimately is so that we could see our need for Jesus Christ. Help us now this morning, we pray, to see the truth of the Scripture, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, chapter 2 and verse 1 begins with a statement that is very, very direct, and perhaps in some cultures not politically correct, because it says, therefore thou art inexcusable. In other words, it simply, plainly says, there's no excuse for you. You have no excuse. And so you can come up with all the excuses you'd like to, but they're all like my high school principal used to say. He'd say, you know what an excuse is? An excuse is the skin of a reason stuffed with a lie. Well, that's Romans chapter 2, verse 1. There's no excuse. You're not going to be able to say, no person will be able to say, God, here's why I did not receive Jesus. You're not going to be able to say, God, the reason I didn't receive Jesus is because I was Jewish. And you're not going to be able to say, God, I didn't receive Jesus because I was a Gentile. You're not going to be able to take your life experiences, anything else, and say that there's an excuse, because the Bible says that which may be known of God is manifest in them, in us. That is, the knowledge of God is manifest. Now we see in chapter 2 that the Jews have the law of God given to them in such a way that there's no way of not knowing there's a God. Imagine with me, if you will, being Jewish, especially in the period that the Apostle Paul was writing to the church at Rome. Your very Jewish identity is a God identity. In other words, what was distinct about Israel? What was distinct about Israel? What?
They're God's people.
I mean, the distinctive about Israel, one of the things that really kind of messed up that distinction was when Israel got a human king. Because they were a theocracy. They were a nation whose king was God. Hey, you ask people, who's your leader? God. That's kind of going straight to the top, isn't it? And so Israel had her identity in God. Where did Israel come from?
Abraham.
And Anne?
Sarah.
Jacob.
And Sarah. And yeah, Jacob. Jacob was Israel. So Israel came from Jacob, from the 12 sons of Jacob, two of which were represented by Joseph's two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. Okay, so Israel came from Jacob, from God's promise to Jacob. Physically speaking, where did Israel come from?
God.
Geographically.
Chaldeans.
Ur of the Chaldeans, that's where Abraham came from.
Canaan.
Well, I mean, family technically did. No, they didn't come from Canaan. I mean, they started there, but where did they come from? Where did national Israel come from? Egypt. They came from Egypt. The entire nation, no exceptions, none of them were anywhere but Egypt. How did they move from Egypt to Canaan?
The Exodus.
They exited Egypt and went to Canaan. Okay, we're getting somewhere. What was the means? Did they take a train?
No.
They walked. How long did it take them to walk into 40, Canaan?
40 years.
40 years. A 40-year walk. Where did they walk?
Through the desert.
Through the desert. How? Yeah, they walked all over the desert, but that's what they did. They walked around the desert, in the desert. They walked around in the desert for 40 years. Wandered, the Bible says, and entered the land of Canaan. How possible is it to wander in the wilderness for 40 years with a couple million people? Walking. What? It's not possible. Most individuals couldn't walk around in the desert for 40 years and go into Canaan. But a couple million people, a few million, What do they eat?
Quail.
Manna and quail. Where'd that come from?
God.
God did. What do they wear?
The original clothes they kept.
They wore the clothes they left Egypt with. And their sandals never wore out. Is there somewhat of a supernatural origin to national Israel?
Yes.
Yes, it is. And any person who is Jewish, whether or not they honored God, whether or not they feared God, knew their origin. And it was supernatural and it was undeniable. Do you ever wonder why there is so much animosity toward God's people, the Jews? That could be answered a lot of different ways, but I believe that the source of anti-Semitism is that the very existence of the Jews is an in-your-face testimony that there's a God to whom you're accountable to. In other words, the fact that a Jew exists is evidence that there's a supernatural God. And if there's a supernatural God, that Jew proves it. It's amazing how even a godless Jew can be hated. A godless Jew can be hated for being Jewish. And he can agree ideologically with everything that the person who hates him believes and still be hated. I've met people, generally speaking, and I'm making a generalism today. I realize it's a generalism, but it's generally true, so I can make it. And so, generally speaking, Jewish people are very liberal. And it's interesting that the people who hate the Jews the most are liberals. It's interesting. In every nation. By liberal, I do not mean generous. By liberal, I mean people who don't believe there's a God. By people who don't believe in morals. Who don't believe in matters of morality that they're important. And those same people, ideologically, the people, God's people, the Jews, agree with him ideologically, and yet they're hated by the people that they're in complete agreement with. It's really amazing to me. Why would you hate someone that votes your way, that supports your cause? Because there's just something about Jews that prove there's a God. And if you hate God, even a Jew that hates God is a reminder that there's a God. Isn't that amazing? It's really true. The Bible says, though, that there's no excuse for anyone, whether they're a Jew or a Greek. But I want to look particularly at some information that's given. First of all, verse 11, when the Bible says thou art inexcusable, the Bible wants to help us to understand you're inexcusable whether you're a Jew or a Gentile. The verses right before verse 11 indicate that after verse 5 says, after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasures up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to every man according to his deeds. By the way, if you are a post-wrath rapture believer, you cannot reconcile Romans chapter 2 and verse 6 with your theology. Because the Bible says that the day of wrath is against those who are, have laid up after hardness and impenitent heart, treasures up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation. Do you realize that God's wrath is not against the righteous? His wrath is against the wicked, the person who's inexcusable. It is astonishing to me how this doctrine that is taught through in the entirety of the Scripture, that God is a righteous judge, that He will judge the wicked, but who in His righteousness has judged His Son in the place of those who will believe, that same righteous God would bring the righteous through the day of wrath or the day of great tribulation. It's astonishing to me because it's an irreconcilable problem theologically. God has never judged the righteous. You say, oh, Pastor, what about Job? God never judged Job, my friend. God never judged Job. Oh, there are sufferings. The word tribulation in the Scripture is used in different ways. But the day of wrath, in context with tribulation, my friend, is for those that hold the truth of God in unrighteousness, period. And Romans chapter 2 indicates such. Now, verse 7, the Bible says, verse 6, who will render to every man according to his deeds. Now, you want to play silly games here, and you want to say that, well, this could be for a saved person who has not lived righteously before God. Let me ask you a question. What saved person could be held accountable for his deeds even as a believer and survive the wrath of God. Not a single one, my friend. Heaven would be emptied. There wouldn't be a person in heaven if God's wrath were against those individuals who are covered by the blood of Jesus. God focused his wrath on his son Jesus when Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And so you are either saved and you are spared God's wrath, not because of your deeds, but because of the righteousness of Christ, or, my friend, you are inexcusable and you will face God's wrath. So either Romans 2 is allegorical and actually has no practical application for the saved and the lost, or it means what it says and says what it means. Okay, that's an aside that isn't the message this morning, but it's important to point out because it's here. Okay, now the Bible says, to them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor, immortality, eternal life, well, God's going to render according to his deeds. What is that? Well, that's a promise of reward for those who love God and live for God. But verse 8, the Bible says, but unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. Again, we find the universal accountability of every person for the wrath of God. I've met individuals that are bothered in their minds by God's wrath. They're bothered by God's judgment. And the argument would be, what about people who don't even know who God is? You ever heard this one? What about people who aren't even aware of who God is? Why is it right, why is it just for God to send them to hell when they never even heard about Jesus? They never even heard about God. Well, we know the answer to that is in chapter 1. I can't preach that message again. I preached it, belabored it long enough. But they know in their hearts, and they know from creation that there's a God, the Bible says. And so we saw that their response can be that they do not like to retain God in their knowledge, but they had God's knowledge. So the answer to that question is, there's no such thing as a person who doesn't know there's a God. And it's interesting when you're dealing with that argument, you're dealing with people that do know there's a God. Notice the people that are so bent out of shape and so concerned about the person who would be judged by God without knowing God exists is not the person that fits that scenario anyway. Notice it's an entirely hypothetical argument that doesn't apply to them. They're mad at God. They're unwilling to believe in Jesus Christ to receive Him because they think God's unfair for not telling some people about Him, but they themselves have been told. And so they're angry over somebody else's business. It's not even their own business. And the answer for it is you're wrong about the assumption that God doesn't love someone enough to let them know who He is. Or God isn't fair enough to let someone know they're accountable to Him before He judges them. There's no such thing. Okay, now this is a passage of Scripture shed some light on the individual accountability. Because the Gentiles could say this, couldn't they? They could say, hey, listen, we never had some supernatural involvement of God in our history. You know, they came from Egypt, and they wandered in the wilderness, and God fed them with manna and quail, and the waters were parted in the Red Sea, and they walked through on dry land, and the waters were parted in Jordan, they walked through on dry land, and they walked around Jericho, walls of a city that two chariots could go by, two chariots wide on. You know, these massive walls fell down, and God did that for them, and they walked into Canaan land. They weren't men of war, and yet God gave them the victory over people that were known for war. And so, yes, Jews should have to believe in God, but God hasn't done anything for the Gentiles like that. Well, we want to see, first of all, that the Jews are accountable, so we'll look at that. We'll also answer the question about the Gentiles. Verse 11, the Bible says there's no respect of persons with God. So there's glory and honor and peace to every man that worketh good, to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. So you do right, God honors it. But the Bible says, no respect of persons which got with God. In other words, God is not going to say, I like you better because you're Jewish, or I like you better because you're Gentile. God says, I've proven my love for you, and you're accountable to me, and you're equally accountable. You ever met somebody that said, well, God just loves some people more than others? You know, they'll take John, where John refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. You know, James is insightful about that. He says, draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. If you want to know God in a way that someone else knows God, my friend, And it's not because God is unwilling to reach out to you. It's because you haven't drawn near to God. The reason John was close to Jesus was because John got close to Jesus. And Jesus got close to John. They had a special relationship. I've met people that feel somewhat slighted by their history. I know there's two kinds, right? There's the guy that got saved from a terrible life and God gloriously saved him and he has this great testimony. And people are always like, wow. The guy is just awful. He did terrible things and then he got saved and God changed his life. And boy, some Christians say, man, I wish I had a testimony like that, but I just got saved as a kid, and I've always just tried to live for God. So there's nothing, spectacular about my testimony. And then there's the people that say, well, yeah, that person knows a lot of Bible. And yeah, I mean, they serve God a lot. They do a lot of things. And, but the thing is, they grew up in church. They got saved at an early age, got saved as a child. They were taught the Bible. They memorized the Scripture. They have an advantage. And sometimes we feel as though somebody, because of his background or pedigree or who his parents were, have an advantage over someone who maybe was the first person in the family to get saved and didn't get saved until they were an adult. The Bible says there's no respect of persons with God. In other words, you might think that matters, but God doesn't. And I find here a refreshing teaching from the Scripture, don't you? I kind of fit in the middle. My dad's a first-generation Christian. But I have friends that were sons of preachers. And man, I'll tell you what, in a lot of ways, they understood philosophy of ministry, they understood spiritual things. They just had a different perspective than I had because of the family they grew up in. And yet, maybe I got saved as a young child, and so I've had a lot more experience of Christianity than a lot of other people have. I kind of feel like kind of one or the other, not really either or. And yet the Bible says there's no respect of persons with God. My friend, your relationship with God is your responsibility. Your spiritual growth is not given to you on the basis of what you could know. Your spiritual growth is given to you on the basis of God being an equal, fair, just God and not being a respecter of persons. God doesn't love you more and God doesn't love you less because of your background, but God judges you more or God rewards you because of what you do with what you have. And every one of us has enough of God to be without excuse. Now, I want to look at four verses in particular today. There's that points that are made. Verse 13 is incredibly helpful, and I want to cross-reference this as well. So be ready to turn to Acts. We're in Romans chapter 2. We're going to read verse 13. The Bible says, "For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified." And tied into it is verse 14. "For when the Gentiles which have not the law do by nature the things contained in the law, these having not the law are a law unto themselves." Everybody understand that the law was given to the Jews? That was their law. It was more than just a spiritual law. It was a physical law that they were supposed to abide by. In other words, their law actually required them to tithe. They had a law that said, give the first fruits. So they had a law. It was a law of the land. They were supposed to tithe. They were supposed to worship at the temple. They were supposed to put away the high places and not worship in the high places. There were a lot of things, because they were Jewish, they were not supposed to. They weren't supposed to marry Gentiles. They were supposed to keep themselves free from pagan practices and idolatry. A lot of things they were required to do because of the fact that they were Jewish. And it was more than just spiritual, it was national as well. And the two couldn't be disconnected. Go with me to Acts chapter 10, will you please? Acts chapter 10. This is, I know, an example in the early church, but I want us to notice something here. Verse 1 is a story, it's a remarkable testimony. The Bible says in verse 1 of Acts 10, "There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band." And here you can insert all your band jokes and about Italian players and guess whether or not he played the tuba or a trombone or a trumpet or whatever it was that Cornelius played. He was a member of the Italian band. He was a centurion in the band. Okay, so it wasn't a musical band. It was a military assignment. And so Cornelius was an Italian man of some influence. So let me ask you a question. What was Cornelius' ethnicity? Roman. He was Roman. He was a centurion of the Italian band, and therefore he was very Roman. The Bible said he was a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to, capital G, God, alway. Here is a man who has no promises ethnically or nationally regarding God and God's covenant to Israel. He's not included in God's covenant to Israel. He is the guy that God uses for Peter to go and to share the truth of the cross to, so that he could not only be saved, but so that he and his house could receive the fullness of the power of God the Holy Spirit. So this individual, Cornelius, is a person, though not Jewish, is a person that is used by God to help the Jewish believers to understand that the gospel wasn't just to the Jews, it was also to the Gentiles. And you know the story, I mean, Cornelius is the guy that God used to get it all started with regard to the change in the church that ultimately ended up with the conclusion that believers were called Christians first at Antioch. So as we're in Romans and we're looking at this contrast between Jew and the Greek, and God says there's no respect of persons with God, isn't it interesting that there's a Bible example of a person who wasn't born with the law, and yet he recognized the God of the Jews? The Bible says he gave much alms. Where was he living? Well, he was living in an area where he would have given alms to the Jewish people. So here's a guy that loves God and loves God's people. He is a person who, as much as he knows how, is devoted to truth. In other words, here's a Gentile who has responded to what he knows about God in his heart. It's interesting. Is it Festus and Bernice? No. What's the king that Paul went before?
Agrippa.
Was it Agrippa whose wife was Jewish? Was it Jewish?
Bernice was Jewish.
Bernice? Well, is it? So was it Festus then? I can't. One of those. It was. I mix all those names up. Festus. What? Was it Felix? Whose wife? No. This is the one where Paul said to Agrippa, you know, I know that. Okay, we can look it up in Acts. I just looked at it a couple weeks ago and had all my ducks in a row, but they're out of order again. My ducks got out of order. And so, sorry about it. But the point of this is that there's a man who was a governor or a king in Israel, and he was Roman, and he believed in the God of the Jews. He married a Jewish wife, but he believed that the God of the Jews was God. Where would a person come under the impression that the God of the Jews is God? How would they come under that impression?
Jews?
Probably not just because of the Jews. What about Nebuchadnezzar? You ever think about Nebuchadnezzar? God said, he is my king. My king, my servant Nebuchadnezzar, God called him. My servant Nebuchadnezzar. And we know that Nebuchadnezzar professed faith in God. Where did that come from? Well, it wasn't because the Jews were such a stellar, shining example of who God was, though some were. Daniel was, for instance. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were, for instance. But how did Nebuchadnezzar come to acknowledge the God of Israel? How did the Queen of Sheba come to acknowledge the God of Israel? How do these things happen? Because everybody knows who God is. That's the honest truth of it. It's in your hearts to recognize God. When you see something that's God, you know, a long time ago I quit trying to prove why other religions were wrong and why Christianity, the God of the Jews and the God of that Jesus Christ is God, I quit proving it because the gospel itself demonstrates that Jesus is God. The gospel itself demonstrates the kind of God that God is. You just preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, my friend, you will dispel a misunderstanding about who God ought to be or about who God is. You tell me a plan of redemption that rivals Jesus Christ, and it isn't just because it's better, it's because it's the only one that really works. He's God. A deity doesn't work in comparison with God. God's greater than any deity. God's greater than any religion. It's amazing when you hear the truth, you recognize it. You say, Pastor, well, I don't agree with you. Well, you've been desensitized as a Christian. Because I'll tell you this, when I preach the gospel to lost people, it's just by declaring the gospel that people believe. It's amazing to me. They have from background so many different assumptions. I've preach the gospel to people that are raised Jewish. And they begin sometimes by saying, well, I can't be saved, I'm a Jew. And I say, everybody needs to be saved. And I preach the gospel to them, and it's amazing that all of the things they've been taught that preclude their receiving Jesus as their Savior are just swept aside when they're willing to believe in Jesus Christ. It's amazing. All the things. You say, Pastor, the questions have to be answered. I'm telling you, God and Jesus answers all the questions. The gospel answers all the questions, all the problems that you'd have. It's amazing. You don't have to debate about which religion is better. Just show people who God is, and if they're willing to believe, it'll all make sense. They can believe it on a faith basis. You don't get saved, my friend, through intellect. You make an intellectual decision to get saved by faith. I'm not saying a person who gets saved casts aside his brain. I'm saying he makes an intellectual decision to receive God by faith, and when he does so, God's Spirit comes into him, and that's a real experience. And that cannot be duplicated. The knowledge of the true God of the Bible can simply be believed. You can just believe the Bible, believe the Scripture. Oh, my friend, there's all kinds of evidence that corroborates the Scripture, that the Bible is the Word of God, but you'll never believe it unless you make a decision to. And that's precisely what the Jews and the Gentiles are accountable for. And the Bible describes unbelieving Jews this way. Back in chapter 2, in verse 13, the Bible says, not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. And God's Word says there are those individuals that have heard what God's Word says. But hearing truth is not the same with God as doing truth. The word justified here is that passive form that means to be made righteous. So a person who hears the gospel is not made righteous. A person who does the gospel is. Now here we are not speaking of the gospel by works. We're speaking of the gospel by the work of faith, or the hearing of faith, actually activating what you hear by doing it. You know, if you hear the gospel but you don't receive Jesus as your Savior, you can get to heaven and say, God, I knew the gospel. I knew that. You ever had an I knew that moment? Many, many times I have done things that have been costly to me, and when I found out the way it actually ended up, I've said, I knew that. I was teasing Brother Al the other day. We were working on the church van. You can't believe I was giving him a hard time, but I was. We were working on the church van, and we had a brass plug. We put the heads on, and we had a brass plug that it was glued somehow into the block, and even heat and temperature wouldn't get it out. We ended up having to drill it out and started to try to tap it. We got it out eventually. But Brother Al hedged his bets on how I was removing the plug. I broke off an extractor tool in it, which is extremely hard steel, and it was in the middle of brass. You know how it is to drill something hard in the middle of something that's soft? Not a fun situation. And I was banging pretty hard on it with a tool that I'd made, sort of like a punch. And Brother Al told me, he said, I don't think you should be banging on that head because you may crack the head and ruin it. And I told him, I said, well, the thing is, I don't really have a choice at this time. I mean, we could tear the engine back down. We could take the head back off. I said, what you're doing is you are hedging your bets. You're trying to make sure that you're right if something goes wrong. In other words, I have to bang on this. I have no choice about it. But if I break the head, you want to be able to say, I told you, you could break the head, just in case it happens. I said, if it doesn't happen, we'll never mention it again. But if it does happen, he's like, yeah, that's kind of true. He admitted it. What's that?
You were right.
Well, it turned out I was right. Yeah, in other words, but it didn't matter if I was right or not. I could have broken. Doing what I did, I thought I wouldn't because I was pounding something hard and something soft. So if something gave way, it should have been the brass. So physics was on my side a little bit. But physics weren't on our side a lot. So there were a lot. We had a lot of problems that went wrong. So he could have been right, but there would have been no earthly good in my listening to his counsel, because the only thing I could do was stop doing what I was doing, in which case we would have never got the job done. So I had to take a chance on something. I said, you're just being careful so that you can be right if something goes wrong, and you can say, I told you so. It's true, isn't it? That doesn't put you in a bad light, Brother Al. There's nothing wrong with that. We all do that, don't we?
It'll be the third time if we have to take that motor plug.
Yeah, we know. It worked out, thank God. The van's there. So we actually started it and drove it. So Anyways, but my point in this is that many, many times when something goes wrong, we say, I knew that, right? If I'd broken the head, if I cracked the head from banging on it, beating out this broken piece of steel that couldn't be ground or drilled, if I'd broken the head doing that, Brother Al could have said, I told you so, and I'd say, I know, I knew it. Okay, but it wouldn't do me any good at that moment. And any person that knows about God and who He is, has even discoursed about God and who He is, can say, I knew that, but it doesn't do them any good unless they exercised faith in what they knew. And God is here saying to the Jew, he can know a lot of things about the law. When Paul would preach the gospel in the synagogues, he would go into the synagogues and he would take the prophets and he would dispute with them, proving that Jesus is the Christ. And when he proved that Jesus was the Christ, people made a choice to believe or to reject Christ. Everyone heard, some believed, and some believed not. And Romans is here making it very apparent that every person is accountable before God for what they've heard, but they have to be a doer in order to be justified. You have to respond. Well, if you study justification in the Scripture, it isn't rocket science to know that the ability to be justified is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Justified is a passive term, which means it's done to us, not done by us. Understanding that grammatical truth, my friend, will help you to understand that it isn't doing that justifies us. It is what we do in order to be justified. Get this? Understand the difference? Some people would say, well, you got to keep the law in order to be justified. Well, the very word justified means that something happened to you. Something was done by you. Get it? In other words, let's equate the word justify with slap. Slap good? Mike asked me to hit him during the service to keep him awake today. And he hasn't even fallen asleep yet, mm-hmm. which is a real shame. So I'm going to slap you anyway, Mike. Is that good? Yeah. Okay, I won't hurt you very much. Okay? All right, so the word justified and slapped. Would you like to justify yourself or would you like me to justify you? Okay. Well, the word here doesn't leave room for self-justification. There are three voices in the language. There's an active voice, which means I'm the one doing the action. Okay, so I'm gonna be the justifier. Everybody get this? I'm the action. Okay. There is a passive voice, which means I'm the one receiving the action or the action's being done to me. And that's the voice that's in. There's also a middle voice, which is I could be doing the action to myself. Okay, so I am the justifier. Justification for this illustration is a slap. And I'll justify you. Now, I'll just tell you, I'm able to slap you. Right? I have the physical ability. Now, you might be able to slap me back. Are you going to slap me back?
No.
Okay. All right, good. Okay, so I'm able to slap you. I have the physical ability while I'm living, breathing, and have my hand to slap you. And you have the ability to be slapped, and it's going to be based on your decision. Mike, would you like me to justify you?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, being justified by pastor. All right. Now, he made a choice there. You get this? In other words, he knew that he could be slapped, and he could have said, no, don't slap me, and he would have been unjustified or unslapped. For sake of illustration. But do you understand that he did something which caused an action to him, but he didn't do the action? And that's the idea of justification here. The Scripture here is not teaching that good works are what justifies us. The Scripture here is teaching that good works are what makes God justify us. And we know specifically what that good work is. If you study 1 John chapter 3, if you study John chapter 3, if you study portions of the Scripture that talk about how it is that we receive Christ is through the believing of faith. And that's a doing of what we've heard. And so the Scripture here says all the Jews have heard the law. But hearing the law and doing the law aren't the same. And the Bible says that the hearers of the law are just before God. But the doers of the law shall be... not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. Until you do that, which activates What God has done, my friend, you're unjustified. And then the Bible contrasts the Gentiles. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law. Cornelius, did we just read about Cornelius? Mm-hmm. Why did Cornelius worship God? Why did Cornelius give alms? Why was Cornelius and his household devout? Because he had the law?
No.
No, because it was in his nature to know there was a God and he knew who God was. That's why Cornelius believed in God. And the Bible says, these having not the law are a law unto themselves. I've illustrated this before. It's pretty easy to understand. Every culture, every place has laws. Even laws about not having laws sometimes. But every culture has a code. Things that you could do that would break the law. They may not be written, but they're understood. The nursery has a code. And I'm not talking about the nursery workers, I'm talking about the nursery children. Try going in the nursery sometime. Don't try, but imagine trying. You've probably seen it tried. Imagine going in the nursery sometime and snatching a doll from one of the little girls.
Try Sailor. It won't work.
Yeah, okay. But if you get the doll, you succeed in getting the law, will Sailor say, yeah, there's neither right nor wrong. The Lord giveth and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Not really. Sailor will smash whoever takes her doll. Why? Because she has a law in her heart. And being the good little Gentile that she is, she knows good and evil. She knows. Matter of fact, I've seen children do wrong and instantly cry. Like they're in trouble. Josiah is the best one ever. This happened with Josiah, I think it was 3 or 4, maybe 4. We were having a fellowship. The Fisick family was moving to Nebraska. We had a cake. We had a party because they were just a kind of a sending off party for them. And Josiah had cake. And I was talking. Brother Nick was sitting there. It was back when the Wheelanders still went to our church. And I was sitting on the front row over another location. And Josiah was sitting. Maybe I was sitting right here and he'd be sitting across a little aisle about right there. And I drank my water and I had just a remnant in the bottom of the cup and I flipped it on Josiah. And he blinked like this. But he had his cake in his little lap, and he had his spoon, pretty big piece of cake. And he had his fork, and he's sitting there. And he blinked, and he just kind of sat there like this, and then he ate his cake. 5 minutes later, a cup of water is dumped on me. And Josiah instantly burst into tears. And you hear his mom go, Josiah! Into that Josiah thing, you know. And she reached for him and I grabbed him because I knew why he threw water on me. In other words, I started it. Now he retaliated very well. And he ate his cake first before he retaliated. Now he had some experience with his parents. Probably thought that maybe Pastor could get away with throwing water on me, but I certainly cannot get away with throwing water on Pastor. And so he, before he ever committed his little crime, he had thought through the consequences of it and was already crying over his consequences when he was executing judgment on me. How do you know that? Was there some code? Is there some written law? If Pastor flicks water on you and you dump water on him, you'll get in trouble? No, it's just he just knows you're probably not supposed to do that. He had a feeling about it. Where the feeling came from? Where did it come from?
God.
Came from his heart. He has a law written in his heart, right and wrong. He knew it was wrong for Pastor to throw water on him, and he knew it was wrong for to throw water on Pastor, and he had a law written in his heart about it. Now, we can be silly about things, but the reality of it is that Gentiles know right and wrong. People can say, well, I didn't, you know, it's just culturally acceptable. My friend, there's right and wrong, and you know it in your heart. It's right and wrong, you know it in your heart. We are going through a massive cultural revolution with regard to the resurging importance of marriage. And this is a good thing, but it's happening. I'm seeing it a lot. People are getting married right now way more than they ever were before. And the reason for it, I believe, is because we've realized that not having families doesn't work. You know, this whole idea of I can be a single dad or I can be a single mom and everything will be just fine. Kids that were raised that way say that's not the way to go. They know it. They know it doesn't work. And there are a lot of things where people are just saying, this just isn't right. It's amazing. I'm having a lot of people come to me and they're saying, Pastor, we've got to figure out how to get married. We don't even know what marriage is. They're coming to me for the help, and it's amazing. I show them Hebrews chapter 13, where the Bible says marriage is honorable and all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers God will judge. And culture right now says there is no such thing as a right or wrong with regard to the physical relationship. Culture has taught that from kindergarten upward, or from preschool upward. And yet, it's amazing how young adults in their 20s, in their 30s, and in their 40s are saying, yeah, the Bible's right about that. It's amazing. Lost people are agreeing with the Scripture, and it's contrary to the culture in which they live. Why? Why? Because they have a law written in their hearts. I will not belabor this any longer. It's true because the Bible says so, and it's true because we can recognize it as it plays out in life. Okay? So those are the two supports for that. The Jews have the law of God, but if they don't do the law, they're not justified. The Gentiles have a law, and it's written in their hearts, the Bible says in verse 15. Now look at verse 17. Behold, thou art called a Jew, and restest in the law, and makest thy boast of God. In verse 18, and knowest his will, and approvest the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law, and art confident that thou thyself art a guide of the blind, a light of them which are in darkness, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which has the form of knowledge, and of the truth in the law. Thou therefore which teachest another, teachest not thyself? Thou that preachest a man should not steal. Dost thou steal? Is there anything more outrageous than a person who purports himself to be a moral or a religious leader who falls or fails morally or religiously? You know, it doesn't bother me that we hold pastors to a high standard. Our Christians ought to be held to a high standard, but it doesn't bother me that we're outraged when a pastor fails morally. And the reason why is because they're supposed to preach morals. And if they preach morals and they don't keep the morals they preach, they're just like a Jew who knows the law and preaches the law and teaches the law and instructs others about how to keep the law, and everybody knows they break the law they teach. We could go on different levels from micro to macro on this, couldn't we? How many parents will not allow their children to lose their temper, and their children are constant witnesses of their parents losing their temper? How many children will not allow their, or parents will not allow their children to indulge their flesh in many ways, and yet the parents constantly in front of their children indulge their own flesh? They want their children to hold a standard that they themselves teach but do not hold for themselves. And so we see that the Jew who says, yes, we have the true and living God, but who does not himself receive God, is inexcusable. And he's more inexcusable because he's taught others the very things that he himself does not affirm. Moving forward, we see, I want to look at verse 20. Well, we see the illustration of it in verse 22. Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege? Now verse 23, our third verse I want to emphasize. Verse 13, verse 17, now verse 23. Thou that makest thy boast of the law, through breaking the law, dishonorest thou God? In other words, it's interesting that this letter to the church at Rome is actually written to the Jews. The gospel is being explained for the lost, but if you'll understand with me, who are the Jews in the church at Rome? Are they believers or unbelievers? They're believers. Now, I'm sure there could be Jezebels and Balaams crept into the church, but the reality of it is that this discourse is more for saved Jews and saved Gentiles than it is for lost Jews and lost Gentiles. Does that make sense to you? In other words, the Scripture in this instance is written to the church at Rome. And a church is comprised not with lost, but with saved people. Get it? Okay. Now, it's not saying that because it's talking about the gospel, it's not describing lost people, because it is. But it's addressed to saved people to help them understand some doctrinal fallacies that they have. And the argument here is that when you make a boast of the law, when you break the law, you dishonor God, for the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you. And it says, as it is written, for circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law. So the specific issue. Now, Paul really gets down to the brass tacks, or where the rubber meets the road, or nails in the coffin, if you will. Paul gets down to the point, and the point is that people in the church at Rome are saying that circumcision makes them better before God than uncircumcision. In other words, the Jews in the church at Rome are kind of flaunting it or lording it over their Gentile brethren because of something that happened to them when they were children, that they were circumcised. And Paul said, the Scripture says that circumcision profits if it's of the heart. And so the point here is that you're inexcusable for what you ought to have done. Yes, you ought to be circumcised, but your circumcision isn't what saves you, and it isn't of the heart. And it goes on to say in verse 27, "And shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by letter and circumcision dost transgress the law?" Paul said there's two sides to the coin. If you think that circumcision is something, then you have to understand that uncircumcision is something. In other words, if you have been circumcised and yet you don't keep the law, then understand that the uncircumcised person, which keeps the law, is exactly what nature made him to be. He's completely natural, except for the fact that that which is unnatural is in him. He obeys the law, and so he's better than you are. So we come to a conclusion today, friend, as before we read the therefore in the end, we come to a conclusion, and the conclusion is that God is very interested in what we do more than what we know. Did you hear me? God is interested far more in what we do than what we know. And let's dispense with any notion that knowing what's right and lording it over others has any profit at all, as opposed to knowing what's right and doing it. And God is not interested in us being knowledgeable for the sake of forcing or pushing other people into what they ought to be. And you and I have both experienced believers in church and probably have had experience of wanting to be that person who knows what's wrong with someone else but is not concerned with what's wrong with us. And Paul boils it all down, he dials it all back, and he says, for a lost person, having the law or not having the law is meaningless because it's receiving Jesus. Whether it's because you had a written law given to you or whether it is because you had God's law in your heart, if you reject Christ, you're inexcusable. And now he says, for you save people. If you had the law and you're Jewish and you want to lord the law over a Gentile and say, now you ought to be circumcised. Now you ought to, but you don't even keep the law that you know yourself. There's no profit in it. And we as believers are accountable to God not to know what somebody else ought to be doing as a judge of another man or another man's servant. But we're accountable to God for knowing the truth of the Scripture and judging ourselves by it. So Paul says in verse 28, for he is not a Jew, this is our conclusion, which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh. Paul said circumcision isn't the thing that happened to you physically. Circumcision is something that happened to you spiritually. And a man can be physically uncircumcised and be a keeper of the law in his heart. And a man can be circumcised and be a breaker of the law in his heart. And God judges the one thing that no man can judge, and that is the heart. The Bible says, neither is that circumcision which is outward. In verse 29, the statement which ties in with a theme that we'll see throughout our study in Romans is, who is a Jew? The Bible says, he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men but of God. As we look at the conclusion here, let us look at the last statement, whose praise is not of men. And believer, every one of us falls into a place where we are motivated oftentimes more by what man thinks than by what God thinks. It is inherently natural for us to ignore the supernatural for what we can physically see. And it is amazing as well how compliant we will be in an area that man will judge us, and how uncompliant we will be in an area that God only judges us. I try to be very careful in our church. I know I fail in places and in times, but I try to be very careful in our church not to set physical standards for our people. And sometimes I think maybe too careful, sometimes maybe not as helpful as I could be. All the time people call and say, "Pastor Price, I'm thinking about visiting the church." A lot of times they say your church, but it's not my church. "I'm thinking about visiting the church." And I say, "Well, good. I'd love to have you. So I got a couple questions first. What's your dress requirements?" That's just funny to me. It's comical to me. And I say, "We don't have any dress requirements. We don't have any such thing as dress requirements." I said, "It would be advisable for you to wear clothing." We're big into that. People will judge you if you don't. But I tell them, honestly, if you were to come on an average service, you'll find that people come in a lot of different ways as far as the standard of dress. I personally have opinions about how a person ought to dress. But it isn't God's standard, and so I don't set that standard. Now, we have in our church leadership dress requirements. In other words, you're going to teach a Sunday school, we want you to dress a certain way. We think that it represents the ministry, and that it's not judging somebody's heart to say, "This is what we want our ministry to be represented as," because we represent the Lord. Everybody get that? But we don't have an opinion about somebody and what they wear. We try to be careful about that, because I don't want somebody to do something that can be done in order to ignore, can do something that could be seen to ignore something that could be unseen. The reality of it is for you men here, it'd be very simple for you to purchase and to wear 3-piece suits. Easier than you think. Believe it or not, a collar and a tie probably won't even choke you to death. I know many of you men think that, but it would. I tried it at an early age and it's never choked me yet, and I've not known anyone choked by one yet. But some of you men think that. Listen, I'm not interested in telling men they ought to wear a suit to church. By the way, I'm not preaching that this morning. Don't misunderstand me. I'm using this for an illustration, okay? I don't tell ladies that they ought to have a modest, full-length dress to come to church. Why? Well, because those are things that men can see. And the truth of the matter is that I have been in churches where people look excellent as far as their standard of dress goes. And you find out that things are not excellent as far as what's actually going on. Been in churches where there are great moral problems and people really focused on a man ought to wear a suit and a woman ought to wear a dress. And yet there are great moral failings that were completely, entirely overlooked because they were concerned with what a man sees, but they were unconcerned with what God sees. And the reality is this: God will judge you and God will judge me. And my concern ought to be with what the judge thinks and not with someone who's interested in setting a standard for themselves. Now let me ask you a question. If we have a preacher visit from the Bible Belt in our church, do you think he'll judge me on the basis of how our people dress? Yeah, he will. He actually will. You betcha. You ever been to the Bible Belt and you look at how people dress for church? It's everything. And if a preacher from the Bible Belt visits here, they'll judge me. They'll say, "Pastor Price has very low standards. Pastor Price, da 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 da." You know what? And you know what I think about that? Not very much. Not very much at all. Because that's looking on the outward appearance. God looks on the heart. And I had far rather have a church of growing people that have a tender heart before God that don't have things that are covered up by a 3-piece suit. Christian, you can cover up, can't you? You can be one thing and come to church and act like another. You can be doing things in secret that God knows about and not care what God thinks, and yet come to church and look just fine. And God is not a person who says, "Wow, circumcision isn't that special. Uncircumcision, that's not as good." God is a person that says, "I see that heart. And I'm not concerned with what people see on the outward appearance because I know what's there." See, the person that looks perfect on the outside, I know what's on the inside. Jesus talked about the Pharisees. They said, "Everything's perfect on the outside." He said, "But you're like whited." believers. On the outside, you're beautiful. On the inside, you're full of dead men's bones. You're corrupt. And Christian, God cares. It matters to God first whether or not you've received God. You cannot say to God that you do not know that Jesus is the Christ, because if you're a Jew, your very law teaches that Jesus is the Christ. And if you're a Gentile, the knowledge of God in your heart corroborates with you that Jesus is the Christ. And so if you do not receive Jesus, you're inexcusable. And if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you cannot look at another believer and say, this is what you ought to be, this is how you ought to look. God says, look on your own things. Look on yourself, because that is precisely what I am doing. And He is. You know, we always think about what somebody else ought to do. Every time I preach a message, almost every single time somebody comes to me and says, you know, so-and-so wasn't here today and they should have been here to hear that message. Almost every time. Twice last week, somebody came to me in two services, three times, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. People came and said, you know, I wish so-and-so were there because they needed that. Just like I did. And just like the people that are here. I stopped being bothered by people that needed the message that weren't there and realized, well, God had the message for the people that were. I've started responding to the needs of the person in my seat rather than thinking about the needs of the person who's sitting somewhere else or is in an altogether different place. Because that's the person God's going to judge, and that's the person I can do something about. And believer, as we begin to look at what a real Jew is, can we begin by understanding that he's a Jew that's a Jew inwardly and not outwardly? And the question for us today is, what are you as God sees you? A couple years ago, I'm finished, but this is a little humorous, so I thought I'd share it. My wife put a verse in the bathroom of the other church. She was trying to kind of decorate. She got this nice little frame, and she put the verse, "Thou, Lord, seest me." I said, "Baby, you think that's a great verse for the bathroom?" People want privacy in the bathroom, and the Lord does see us, but let's just put that verse somewhere else. But God does see us. God does see us. And He knows the heart. And Christian, I know you and I could get together and we could really write a book on what's wrong with everybody, couldn't we? Or we could get with the Lord and we could do business about what's wrong with us. And that's the conclusion of our message this morning. Father, I pray that you would bless and move our invitation. Now we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.